Hey everybody, today Rado runs through Bruges, which is Stefan Feld's version of the card game where cards can be used for all kinds of different actions, like Race for the Galaxy or San Juan. And let's see Stefan's take on it, shall we? Okay, now this is set in the city of Bruges, and players are running sections of the city trying to build houses, get various and sundry people to come and live in their section of the city so they can provide actions, score points, etc., etc. There's a whole bunch of stuff going on, and rather than spend a lot of time on preambles, we're just going to jump right into it. At the beginning of the game, each player gets $5. One of each of the five colors of workers that you can have, although they're not workers in a, well, I guess they are kind of worker placement workers, but yeah, so basically you get one of each of the four, five colors of workers, and these little markers that will indicate later on if we have earned first place status in any of several things. That's the whole setup, and you put the stuff out on the board, and we start playing. Now, the first thing that happens in every round is, in player order, players draw up to five cards. And at the beginning of the game, we have no cards in our hands, so I'm going to draw five cards. And I've got two decks over here that I can draw from. And all I know is that on the top of these two decks, this deck has a yellow card, you can see, and this deck has a brown card. So do I want to draw a yellow or brown card? And just to explain why they're in these cups, this is the German version of the game, where I've had to do these paste-ups of, you know, these very, very nicely done. Thanks to whoever it was on BoardGameGeek who put this stuff together. BoardGameGeek is down at the moment, so I can't look his name up, but they're really well done. Thank you so much for making this game playable. But anyway, so you can see I put them all in these sleeves, and this, to hold them in place, and the sleeves make the cards very, very slippery. And it's very important that when I'm picking a card, I can't see the color of the card underneath it, so Jan and I use these cups to keep them straight. Sorry, totally as an aside, just wanted to explain it. Anyway, so I've got to decide of my first of my five cards I'm going to draw, do I want a yellow or a brown? And I'm going to take a yellow, and I'll explain why. Although I don't get to look, you know, that's what the other side is, I don't get to look at the other side yet. I have to draw all five cards before I find out what actual cards I got. But I've drawn a yellow, and the reason I chose a yellow is because looking over here on my portion of the board, I could use a yellow card right here to start building this canal. But I'll talk more about that later. But that was, you know, right now, yellow card and blue card are particularly appreciated by me because they would help me build canals in this yellow and blue spot. But there'll be lots of other uses for cards too. But anyway, so I've drawn my first. I've got to draw four more cards. And now I'm choice between brown and brown, neither of which I'm particularly excited for. So let's go ahead and I'll come from here. And I get another choice between brown and brown. Okay, I'll take another brown, that's fine. Oh, and then I get a purple. Okay, I'll take a purple. And for number five, and a blue. Okay, those are my five cards. And now that I've drawn them, I can look at them. Let's see what we got. The ragman, the advocate, the priest, the trade captain, and the prophet. These are all people that I could, well, if I build a house for them, they could come and live in my section of town and give me abilities like take $3. Take one yellow worker and 3 points. You know, there's a whole bunch of things they do. But before we actually get into the situation where I'm playing these cards, Jen, the second player, this is a two-player game, is now going to draw her four cards. Let's see, and she actually wants brown and blue. I mean, there'll be other reasons she chooses colors, but right now, at the beginning of the game, those are kind of, that's the main determining factor. And hey, there's two browns. So I guess she'll take this brown, randomly. And then there's a purple. She'll take the other brown, because she would actually like to have multiple rounds, I think. And then there's a blue. She'll take a blue. Three. Let's see, a purple or a yellow. My avatech. This point's kind of random. Take a purple. And a purple and a, or a yellow and a red. Okay, and what the heck? A red. Does she? No, she'll take a yellow as well. Okay, and that leaves for the next round at the top of the deck, there's a purple and a red card, which, you know, is something we need to bear in mind as we're getting ready for the next round, that Jen, who will be the first player next round, she will have choice right off the bat of a purple or red. That might change what she does. But anyway, this is her starting hand of cards, and we'll look at them and start thinking about what she's going to want to do with all these cards in a second. Because now we move on to phase two of a round, the Werfen. We've done the Kartenscheisen, or Schießen, or Schien, Zien. Now we're doing the Werfel, whatever. Basically, we do the dice and find out what happens. You notice there are five colored dice here, so what we do in this phase, we roll them, and we arrange them in descending order. Let's see, wow. And now we deal with the ramifications of these dice, because this kind of indicates what has happened in the city of Bruges this month, or this round we're about to play. When you roll, any die that is a 5 or 6 causes a catastrophe in that color. And so you can see, we've had a red, yellow, blue, and purple catastrophe. Anything that's a 3 or 4, we don't care about. And anything that's a 1 or a 2 adds up to like this series of public works that players can do to gain some points. We'll worry about that in a second. Let's do the catastrophes first. So there's a purple, which means both Jen and I get one purple marker. A blue, we both get one blue marker. We both get one yellow marker. You can see there's a yellow 5 there. So right off the bat, we are starting with a little bit of trouble in Bruges. Now let's actually look at these markers and talk about them. The red is fire. There's potential of fire. There's potential of revolt. There is potential of flooding. And there is potential of intrigue. These four things that are happening right now. The only thing that didn't happen is there's, at this point anyway, there's no potential of plague. No browns came up. So what's going to happen is nothing bad right now. These are all things that are brewing on, you know, off in the distance. But on future turns, if we roll more colors, and if I ever get a second red and a third red, that means the fire happens to me. Maybe it happened to Jen, maybe it not, depends on, but if ever I get all three of reds, I would have to deal with the fire, which means either one of my buildings or one of my canals would go up in smoke. That I built. But anyway, right now, we've got four potential catastrophes on the horizon, and Jen has the exact same thing, the exact same layout. Okay, then there's also this issue of if either of us, and I'm the star player, so I have to choose first, if either of us want to pay $2, we can move forward one step on the prestige track. And you know, this kind of represents us, I don't know, giving money to the city for various and sundry things that makes the city appreciate us more. And so I have to choose first, and I am going to pay $2. I started with $5, so I'm going to pay two of my $5, and I'm going to go from nothing to 1 point. That's 1 point that I will score at the end of the game. And now Jen has to decide if she's going to, and if I'm going to do it, she's going to do it, and I'll explain why later. She is also going to pay $2, and so she's done it well. Now, during this phase, doesn't matter how much money you have, doesn't matter how much it costs, you can only move forward one space. So we both made it to step one on this point scoring track. Okay, that was the end of phase number two, the Würfeln. Now we can move on to the Karten Ausspielen, which is the core of the game. We are now going to play our cards. We will actually play four. We take turns playing one card per, and we will play four of the five cards, which means we'll have one card left over for next round. And so let's do it. Now I'm first player, so I'm going to be the first person to play a card, and now I really need to pay a little bit more attention to what my cards are and what they can do. Although, let's see, this is an overview. It's kind of nice. The cards, I have a really nice summary that tells you, remember I said this is a game where this card can do a lot of different stuff. What can it do? I can play this card to get two blue workers. I can play this card to get money. And to find out how much money, I'd look over and see that, hey, this turn I rolled a blue 6. So if I use this blue card to get money, I would get $6 or florin. I could use this card to dismiss one chunk of danger towards blue, which, what is blue? Blue is the flooding. So if I could use this card to basically put my time and attention towards shoring up the shores, and I would get rid of this. And by the way, every time you get rid of one of these danger bits that are, you know, building, you score 1 point immediately. So I could use this card to get rid of that blue and score a point. I could use this card to build a canal. If I'm at a blue space. And right now, at the beginning, I could build my canal in this direction or this direction, because this is my portion of the city canal, and I would need either a blue or a yellow. So I could use this blue card to help build the canal. I couldn't use this purple card, because I don't use purple to build my canal until I get up to this point or this point. I could use a blue for that, or I could use this blue card to build a blue building. And to build a blue building, I would play the card, and I would have to get rid of my blue worker to build this blue building, and then this becomes a place that I could hire somebody else and have them live in this house. And then the final thing is, I could actually hire this. I would have to pay $9. He's very expensive, but then I would have a priest living in a house in my area if I built a house first. And then he gives me this, the priest in this case, this icon means it's a one time. He gives me this ability, take one yellow worker and 3 points. So if I build him, I will instantly get 3 points and one additional worker, but he's gonna cost me $9 to hire this guy, and I'll have to have a house to put him in. So that's just an example of what I can do, and I've got 5 cards to choose from. And so over the next 4 turns, I will play 4 of these for any combination of those particular things. Let's see. Action take. Right. Okay. So I need to think a little bit about what do I want to use these cards for? Do I want to use them? Do I want to actually build a house, put them in there so I can get their special ability? Or do I want to use this one to get two brown workers? Do I want to use this one to get rid of one of my, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So thinking about it, which of these cards do I actually want to get the power? I mean, this trade captain, whenever I activate him in the future and I'll need a blue guy to activate him, I can just get $3. Money is hugely important in this game, so that's nice. The prophet, take $2 or guilders, not florin, guilders, when for each person in a church. So this is interesting. I mean, you know, these cards come in different classifications. Priest and prophet, they're both of the church class. I've got a knowledge and underworld. So, you know, this prophet is nice because if I had both these guys living, every time I use the prophet and I need a brown worker for that, I would score 4 points. And if I get more workers over the course of the game, this prophet would become even more powerful. The ragman, once per round, take 1 gold for each 6. So, like, you know, if I have him, right, this turn, 2 sixes are rolled, and I'd be able to use him to get $2, and I'd be able to do that for free for the rest of the game, because he has no costs once I've actually put him into a house. So these are all nice things, but I'm thinking, as much as I'd like this priest, you know, because he had 3 points, he's a really big deal, I'm going to save this so I can use it to build in this blue canal space. So I think I'm going to do that this turn. And so if I'm gonna use him for that, then I gotta think about what do I want the other use with the other guys for. See, I could use this yellow guy to build in, you know, build in this yellow space. So I could have both these guys just devoted to building a canal, and that would take me $1, $2, and I've still got $3 left over. So maybe I want to do that, which would leave just these guys. Do I want to do something else with them? Chances are, I want to build a house and put one of them in my house. And, you know, of all of them, this guy's the most powerful, but he would cost $9. And I've only got $3 left. Now, I'm going to pay $2 to build a canal. It's unlikely. Well, but there's a lot of money to be had because all these high numbers rolled. So I think, for starters, I am going to, my first move, of my 4 moves I'm going to take this turn, I'm going to use this advocate, not for his ability, not to build a house, not for a canal, not to get rid of this purple danger, not to get 2 purple workers, but instead to get $6. So I discard him, and I've just scored $6. That was my first move, and now it's Jen's first move. And now I got to go over and look at her hand and think about what she's going to do. DTT. Okay, so she got 2 browns, a blue, purple, and a yellow. And what's her situation? Okay. So these are all, you know, fire breather. Each time you place a person in your display, discard 1 threat marker of the person's color. Oh, wow. And take 1 point. So this fire breather automatically takes care of trouble. You immediately activate all the people who require workers without cost. Wow. But no surprise. These guys are both very expensive at $9. The singer is free, though. Once per round, if the blue is a 5 or a 6, take 1 blue worker. The blue is a 5 or 6 right now. That's nice. Gatekeeper. Build a canal tile at no cost, but it's a one-time thing. I'd only ever get to do it once. I wouldn't want to use him right now because right now, at the beginning, the canals are really cheap. But later on, when a canal costs 5, it'd be great to play him, but I don't think I'm going to have him in my hand then. He will be long gone by then. Charlatan. All their players must take 1 brown threat marker. So if I play him, and I get, wow, Jen could hit me every single turn, keep throwing brown plague markers at me, and if I get the plague, if the plague hits me, I end up losing people from my town. He costs 6. I think Jen is going to set out to get him, and get him into so she can use him over the course of the game. So now to actually get this guy in Jen's town, she's going to need $6 to basically entice him to come into her portion of town, and she's going to need a house for him to live in. And she's going to need money for that $6. She only has $3 left. So first thing she's going to do is, like me, I think she is going to trade in a purple card like I did to make $6. So that was Jen's first turn. And she's starting to think of a strategy. Okay, back to me. Now it's my second turn. Okay, I got my money. And now I want to start building canals. So I'm going to take this priest. He could do a bunch of different things. I could get workers, etc. But I'm going to use him to build a canal. So I discard him, and as you can see, blue canal at this point from my starting position requires 1, so I pay $1. That means I have $2 left over, and I have built a canal. Now it's back to Jen's turn. She's like, oh, well, I think she's going to continue with her plan of wanting to get this charlatan out. So this charlatan needs a house to live in. And I think, let's see. Okay. So, it's just tough. All right. Alrighty. Jen is going to build a house with this actor, which means she doesn't get a chance to use the actor's ability. She doesn't do anything else. Instead, what she does is, to build a house, she flips the card, and she now has a yellow house. This will be worth 1 point at the end of the game. But to build this house, she has to discard her yellow worker, and she started with one of each color. So Jen's second thing was, she took this yellow card and built a house in her portion of town. Now back to me, back to my turn. And I'm like, oh, Jen's built a house. Maybe I better build a house too, so I can get a person in town. Let's see. Because I was mostly thinking about I'd use this yellow guy to continue working. Oh, I could use this brown guy to continue working on the canal. I think I want to do that. But if I want to put a person in a house, I think, yeah. Okay. I am going to, oh, but I've got a brown yellow. I could build all the way up to three canals right now and really scream ahead on canals. But then I'd be letting Jen get ahead on houses. And I don't want her to get ahead of me on that. So I'm not gonna let that happen. I'm gonna build a house too. I like this trade captain more than this ragman. I think he's a little bit less interesting. So I am going to take the ragman's card, flip it to build a brown house. And to do that, I had to get rid of a brown guy. Okay, that was my next move. Jen's turn. She's got three more cards. Two more of them she's gonna play. She is now, remember, here's the charlatan. She's gonna pay $6 of all the money she made to move the charlatan into her house. And now she has this guy living, and this is interesting. You might expect that the brown card has to live in a brown house. That's not the case. Any color character can live in any color house. It doesn't really matter about that. They don't care about the house. It's, hey, it's a nice house. I'll live here. And now Jen has got a guy who, whenever she likes, she can spend a brown worker to activate his power. And you know what? You can activate a person as soon as they come out. So she's going to do it. At the end of her turn, she played this. That was her turn. And at the end of her turn, she will actually activate the charlatan with her brown worker, which only leaves her with three colored workers left. With her brown worker and all other players, in this case just me, must now take a plague marker. And so now I got five kinds of trouble coming my way over the course of the game. That was Jen's turn. Now it's my next turn. And I think I will get this captain out. I'll move him into a home. As you can see, he requires $3 to get in. And now he'll be worth one victory point at the end of the game for me, as will this house. I'm going to send on 2 points right here. Jen, her house is 1 point, but this charlatan is worth 2 points because it costs so much more. Anyway, so I've made that guy. And like Jen, I can use this guy immediately. So I will use him immediately to put a blue worker on him because he needs a blue worker to immediately take $3. So basically, I got this guy not for $3, but for a blue worker. And so I've still got money. Okay. And that, by the way, was the last card. I have now played four of my five cards, which means I'm going to hold on to this yellow card, this profit, for next turn. Okay. And Jen, meanwhile, she's got one more card to play. And what does she want to do? Let's see. She got a brown. Now, she's got this charlatan who has this power of being able to give me plagues, but she needs more brown workers. So she could take this gatekeeper and turn him in to get two more brown workers so she'll be able to hit me more later. Alternatively, she could use this blue card as her last move to get $6 so she has more money in the future. Or she could use it to build her first canal piece. I think that's what she's going to do, because she doesn't want to fall behind me on canals. And I'll explain about that in a second. So she is going to use the singer. She won't get the power of the singer. She could get a lot of money, but instead she's going to use her to build a canal. So she's giving up a blue card to build in this blue space. That costs $1, which means Jen now has $2 left over at the end of the round. And so she is holding on to this gatekeeper at the end. And that was the end of the round of the Karten Ausspielen portion. And now we get to the last portion of a round, which is the Überprüfung der drei Mehrheiten. Which is to say, we compare in the three categories if anybody has pulled ahead, and if so, register that they have pulled ahead. The three categories are moving up on this public acclaim track for donating money to the city. We're both tied, which means neither of us could flip this over and be in a position to score 4 points at the end of the game. Next one is the canals. And you can see both Jen and I built one canal, so neither of us gets 4 points for pulling into the lead on that. And then finally, the last one is having people, and both Jen and I have one person, so nobody pulled ahead on that. So Jen and I are staying neck and neck on all three of those things. And that was actually a conscious choice, because once somebody pulls ahead, let's say Jen had not, she had used that six, that blue guy, not to build a canal, that blue card, her not to build a canal, but instead to make $6, so she'd have more money next turn. That means I would have a canal, Jen wouldn't, and I would get to flip this, and that means I've guaranteed gotten 4 points at the end of the game. Now later on, it doesn't matter if Jen catches up with me on canals, I still have it. Even if Jen surpasses me on canals by building, a second canal, I would not lose this 4 points. But at that point, Jen would also get it, because these things indicate, was there ever a point in the game where you were in the lead? And the reason, these are so important is because once one person has gotten ahead of you, once one person has scored this, it's very easy for, it becomes difficult for everybody else to catch up with them and surpass them so that they can score those 4 points. And so that's why when I saw Jen building a house, I decided to build a house so I would keep, in lockstep with her. When Jen saw I built a canal, she decided to build a canal, so we're staying neck and neck. We don't want to give anybody, the lead on these points. And so that was the end of the first round. And so a new round starts. And the first thing that happens in the new round is these workers who we use for their special powers are gone. The first player marker moves on, so Jen will be first player. And now we draw up to 5 cards again. And remember, Jen has one card left over, this brown guy, who she's likely going to use this brown card, not for any of the other things, but to basically get more brown workers so she can fire her charlatan. And so she's going to start deciding, drawing, does she want a red card or a purple card? And neither of those are particularly exciting to her right now, so she'll take a red and see what she gets. That's one, and then she gets a yellow. She does want a yellow, because the next step on her canal is yellow. That's two, and she gets two more. Another brown. Browns are good, because remember she's got a charlatan, so she likes pumping up brown workers. Three, and she gets one more, and now it's two purples. What the heck? Random luck says take this purple, and that's her hand. And now me, I draw up to five. I've got a yellow left over, which I'm going to be able to use. I might want to build him, any number of things I might do with him, but let's see, a red and a purple. See, I would like yellow or brown because of my canal. Neither of these are exciting, so I'll take a red and see what else I get. A red, two purples, what the heck, I'll take a purple, a brown, come on. A brown is good. Yeah, I wanted a brown. Three, and see, the colors I want would be brown, yellow, or blue, because I want to get more blue workers so I can fire my trade captain. But unfortunately, bad luck for me, no blue cards have come out. So with my fifth card, I'll take another purple. And that's my hand. Jen's got her hand of five. Then the dice get rolled. We see what terrible things happen. Okay. So one terrible thing happened. Fire continues to get closer. It becomes, it's a very real danger now. Next year, next month, or whatever it is, we may very well have a fire, because we just need to get, red needs to be high one more time. But no, nothing else bad happened. However, the cost of donating to the city to, increase our prestige is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's ridiculously expensive. That's hugely expensive. And as it happens, Jen cannot afford it. She only has $2, but me, because of my captain, I've got money left over. I am, even though it's crazy expensive, I'm gonna pay $6. And now I have taken the lead on this, which means at the end, unless Jen can do something, I will get the 4 point thing, and then hopefully I'll be able to hold on to that lead for the rest of the game and deny Jen ever getting that 4 points. So that was the end of that. And now we can begin playing, and Jen will be the first to play her cards. What did she get? She's got $2. She's a little bit worried about that fire. And let's see. She's got two brown cards. She's going to want to turn one of them in to get another brown worker to send more plague my way. And the gatekeeper, you recall, the gatekeeper lets you build a canal for free. When he gets created, this means as soon as he comes to your town, you immediately use him, and it's a one-time thing. Jen could pull ahead this round on getting more canals out. Alternatively, the tower guard, when you build a canal tile, you may discard a threat marker of the same color and take 1 point. Okay, and this becomes a permanent thing for the rest of the game. Whenever Jen builds canals, it can help her mitigate the danger of, these things, and it's a great way to score points. One of these browns she's going to want to turn into a worker. These are both great browns, though, but this guy is free. This guy costs $6. She's only got two. She'd have to make some money, and right now the only way to make money is off of red, which means Jen would have to turn her pastor in to get $6, and so on. Now, I'm going to stop right there, because you're just starting to see the basics of how this game plays and what kind of strategy and how you have to, just every turn, do the best you can with the cards you've drawn, considering the fact that there's a million different things you can do with them. Now, if you'd like to see some more of this action and start to watch as the game accelerates and things get bigger and dangers start to mount up and Jen starts sending plague over my way and I start reaping the benefits of pulling ahead here and we start building more and we start getting synergy between the cards and blah, blah, blah. If you want to see some more of that, go on ahead and press the button that's on screen right now to watch the extended gameplay where I'll run through a few more rounds. Alternatively, if you'd like to go straight to final thoughts, the other button is on screen. I leave the decision in your capable hands in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Thanks, everybody.